the problem must go.
This afternoon, return joy to you in the name of Jesus.
Every arrow and every shoot that you will break,
yes,
in the name of Jesus.
I command every door of favor, every door of breakthrough,
yes,
every door of blessing,
yes,
to swing open for you and all yours in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. We've been looking at the issue of grace. 2 weeks ago, I was privileged to minister here, and I stepped into part two of contacting grace through prayer. I'm going to close it out in the little time we have today so that we see what the Lord has for us next week. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Open your Bibles with me once again to 1 Chronicles. I don't know why we are dwelling in Chronicles. There's a lot of going to Chronicles. Amen. We are looking at chapter 5, and then we'll pick it up from verse 18 to verse 23. And looking at it all evening yesterday and all night, I wish I could preach this again, but I'm going to do my best to finish. Just follow me as we go. Amen. I'm going to read from the KJV. Then we will read the same scripture from the New Living Translation. Amen.
Amen.
And I'm praying that you will see what I saw in Jesus' name.
Amen.
The son of Reuben, the Gadites, the half tribe of Manasseh. Now, there are 12 tribes in Israel. Because some of you, except you have been in this church for a few years, that when we were doing a book study on the book of Joshua, you may not understand what is happening here. The 12 tribes of Israel, when they were about to enter the promised land, at the other side of Jordan, 2.5 tribes, those 2 tribes, the tribe of Reuben, Gad, and the half of the tribe of Manasseh, decided to stay on that side of the Jordan. They didn't want to cross over to Canaan. Amen. Moses permitted it, but he told them they will not settle down until they have helped their brethren to take over their own land. So they followed to cross over, fought the war. Joshua led them to fight the war, and then after the war, they went back to their own land. And they were dwelling there, and some enemies rose against them, and that is where we are now. So the sons of Reuben and the Gadites, the half tribe of Manasseh, valiant men, men able to bear buckler, men able to carry sword and to shoot with the bow, skillful in war. They were what? 44,760. And they made war with the Agarites, with Jeter, and with Nephish, and Nodab. And they were helped. Look at verse 20 very well. We have camped around it for some time. They were what? They were helped against them. Who helped them?
God.
Uh-huh. And the Agarites were delivered into their hands, and all that were with them. For they what? They cried to God in the battle, and God was entreated of them, because they put their trust in him. And they took away their enemies' cattle, their camels. How many? 50,000. Sheep, how many? 250,000 of asses or donkeys, how many? 2,000. And slaves, how many? 100,000. That was a great spoil. For there fell down many slain, because the war was what? The battle became God's battle. And they dwell in their land until they were taken into captivity. Verse 23. And the children of the half tribe of Manasseh dwelt in the land. Then they did what? They increased from Bashan unto Baal Ammon, and Senir, and unto Mount Ammon. You shall increase in Jesus' name.
Amen.
You will dwell in your land safely, and God will expand your coast in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Now quickly, for clarity, let's go to the New Living Translation, follow on the screen if your translation is different. From verse 18, New Living Translation. There were 44,760 cavalry warriors in the armies of Reuben, Gad, and the half tribe of Manasseh. They were all skilled in combat, armed with shield, sword, and bows. They waged war against the Agarites, the Jeturites, and the Nephites, and the Nodabites. They cried out to, they did what? Were they crying, oh, 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 oh? Is that what they were doing? They cried out means what? They prayed. You people are very spiritual. Amen. Uh-huh. Okay. During the battle, and he did what? Thank God, God was not on transfer. He was not on vacation. If God has gone to Hawaii, what will have happened? Because some people, their God goes on vacation.
Yes.
You can only see in a certain period of time. Some, their gods have waking up time. If you call him before he wakes up, he won't answer you. Don't you read on Mount Carmel, when Elijah challenged the prophets of Baal, and he said, let the God that answered by fire, let him be God. And the Bible said, the prophets, he said, give them a pool. The biggest one said, pick the one you like. They picked the fattest one. And the Bible said, they called upon their God from daybreak till evening. They cursed themselves. They screamed, they jumped. But their God was either sleeping or the communication was didn't go through. Maybe he was using, I won't say, I didn't say we, you said we. Amen. But the connection did not go through. But when the man of God stepped up, in under 5 minutes, the fire of the Lord came down. Consumed everything, the water, the sand, everything. Amen.
Amen.
Thank God, this their God is still the same Jehovah that we serve. He answers prayer. Their prayer, because they trusted in him. So the Agarites and all the Allah and all their allies, they were what? Defeated. All your enemies shall be defeated.
Amen.
Listen, I'm not talking of next year. I'm talking of your enemies. They will not live beyond this week.
Amen.
Some of you don't want to say amen.
Yeah.
Allow them to live for the next 50 years. My own will not go beyond this week.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Some of you are just full of mercy. Amen. The plunder taken from the Agarites included 50,000 camels. 250. How many people went to war? 44,000. I begin to see what they took back. That was why I said it was a great spoil. 500,000, 50,000 camels. Even if every man takes two of this thing, it's still good. 250,000 sheep. Of goats, how many goats? Sheep and goat. 2,000 donkeys. 100,000 slaves. Amen. Verse 23. And many of the Agarites were killed in the battle because God was fighting against them. The people of Reuben, Gad, and Manasseh, they did what? They lived in their land until they were taken. No, they were taken to exile because they became disobedient to God. Amen. That's not where we are looking for today. But God delivered them. And then verse 23. The half tribe of Manasseh was very large. Half tribe became very large. Even if you are half today, you are going to be very large. I'm saying, no, your beginning may be small,
yes,
but your latter end shall be great.
Yes.
That shall be your story in the name of Jesus.
Yes.
They spread through the land, you will spread through this nation.
Yes.
You will spread through this nation in the name of Jesus.
Yes.
Amen. And from Bashan to this and to this and to that. Somebody said, let the word of the Lord be blessed.
Yes.
My assignment is to close out. What have we been looking at? Looking at this story. We've been looking at releasing grace. Grace gave them the victory. But they did something to release the grace. And we said, that prayer is one of the keys to releasing the grace or to accessing the grace of God. See, everything God has done, everything God will do for man is wrapped up in grace. Jesus is grace personified. But to access that grace, we need to do some things. And the purpose of this teaching is to take us through the series. So the first one we are looking at is the key of prayer. Prayer is one way to accessing or releasing the downpour of grace. Now, we saw that 44,000 people went to war. But their strength, the Israelites were victorious, not because of their warfare strategies. There was no mention of their strategy. Even their commander was not mentioned. But there were people that were skilled, trained in warfare. But they did not win because they have superior strategy. They won because God's grace was made available to them. And they accessed that grace of God through prayer. They cried to Him. They cried to Him and He answered them and helped them. So every time you call upon God, God answered you and you receive help. That was why Hebrews 4:16 said, come boldly to the throne of grace so that you may find help and receive grace to help in the time of need. The Amplified Bible said, well-timed help coming just when you need it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Many of us know that grace is what makes a difference. But what we don't know is how do I unlock that grace? So it looks as if the heaven over us is locked up. There is no rain coming down. But from today, I see your heaven opening up.
Yeah.
I see showers of blessings coming upon you in the name of Jesus.
Yeah.
We are in the realm of abounding grace. That is where we are. Because we are in the last of the last days. We are in the realm of abounding grace. But prayer is key. And we will see some other keys in the subsequent weeks that are coming. Grace we define it as the totality of helps from above, which will help you and I to fulfill destiny in grand style. Grace is the total or the sum total of every help man will ever receive from God to fulfill his or her destiny. Amen. See, great plan with great grace culminates in great accomplishment. And in this story, in verse 20 and verse 22, God took over their battle. They cried to God in verse 20. In verse 22, the Bible says God fought their battle. There's a song we used to sing. Fighting my battle. What's that song? Bringing in my miracle. And sing it as if you know it now. I can sing. Fighting in my battle. Amen. We sing that song, but there is a catch phrase there. In that verse 20, the Bible said, they trusted in Him. They cried. So it's not just the crying. You can cry, but if you don't trust in the one you are calling to help, amen, you will still not deliver. They cried to Him, and they left the issue in His hand. And in verse 22, He showed up. He personally slew a lot of their enemies. Amen.
Amen.
Now, I want to share with you six things that makes prayer effectual. Six things that makes prayer. Because every man prays. Every woman, especially, there are many praying mantis in the church. They pray. But not everyone has results to show. But we can see that these two and a half tribes, they cried to God and they got result. Amen.
Amen.
The first thing that I want you to know, I have 6 things here, and I'm believing God to just go through them today. The first one is the heart connection. Connectivity with God. Come with me to John 17, John 15, 7. John 15, 7. If you abide, now give me the NIV. Let's use the NIV here. If you remain in me, and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish, and it will what? Did the Bible say it may?
No.
It shall, it will. That's a statement of finality. But the condition is you must remain in him. Not only that, his word must live in you. So is the word of God living in you, and are you remaining in Christ? What does it mean to remain in him? It simply means to have nothing else to him. Because I've discovered there are still some Christians, they look for help from Egypt. The one leg in Christ, one leg in Egypt. You can't be Goshen and Egypt at the same time. Some of us, we still put one leg in Nigeria, one leg in Canada, in future. It doesn't work. That's not remaining in him. Say, whatever the name of Jesus cannot deliver for you, may you never have it.
Amen.
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 Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
He said, if his words remain or is alive in you, there is nothing you ask that you will not receive. So if you have been asking and you have not received, check yourself. It's not really God. It's not God that is refusing. Maybe his words are not living in you, or maybe you are putting one leg out. Amen.
Amen.
You see, in Proverbs 23, 26, God is asking for only one thing from you and I. He said, my son or my daughter, give me, did he say, give me your money?
No, sir.
Give me your certificate?
No, sir.
He said, give me your heart. That's what, if your heart is not with him, if you cannot commandeer what is in his hand. There has to be a heart connection with God. That is the foundation. Your heart must be connected with him. The Bible says God spoke testimony about David. He said David was a man after my heart. There was a heart connection between David and God. And that was why David became the greatest king. He fought over 60 battles. He never lost one. Amen.
Amen.
Because he settled this issue. Amen. His heart beats after God. He said, like the deer pants after the bull, so my heart pants after you. Early will I seek you. He was addicted to God. People that are addicted to God, that their life centers around God, everything they do, they will find a way to bring God into it. There is nothing they ask that they don't receive. Amen.
Amen.
There must be a heart connection. And also, you say, what disconnects our heart is living in the state of sin. See, listen very well. I'm not talking of the act of sin. I'm talking of living in the state of sin. You will have acts of sin once in a while. You will miss it. If not, 1 John chapter 2 shouldn't be in the Bible, written to the church. If you are not, if God knows, you won't miss it. But because you miss it once in a while, that is different from living in the state of sin. That you are just relishing in it, you enjoy it, you don't feel any remorse, you are okay with it. That will disconnect your heart from God. Amen. And see what the Bible says. David said this. This is what David said in Psalm 66, verses 18 to 19. Now let's use the New Living Translation here for study's sake. He said, if I had not confessed the sin in my heart, the Lord would not have listened. So if the issue is not that you sin, the issue is that what do you do after you sin? Do you remain and continue, or do you repent and back off? Amen. He said, if I had not, but see verse 19, he said, but God did listen. So for God to have listened to him, what do you think he did? Didn't you read the story? He fasted, he prayed for the baby not to die. But when the baby died, the guy got up. When Prophet Nathan came to him, did he shift blame? No, he won't know. That's confessing. And there was no remedy for adultery during the time of David. There was no forgiveness for murder. But David got away with both of them. He got away with both of them because he confessed. He won all. And that was why God said that he punished me. It's true, I did it. Unlike Saul, what did Saul do? God said, it's the people. It's not really me, it's the people. And God said, who is leading? Amen. So this is a major disconnection of our heart from answered prayer. And if we stay away from this, we don't live in a state of sin. Now, if you miss it, don't beat yourself on the head. Don't condemn yourself. Just talk to him. 1 minute, you have settled it. It doesn't take 3 months. In fact, you don't need to go and fast and pray to confess your sin. Because when you are fasting, that's not the time he saw what you did. Before you did it, he saw you. When you are doing it, he saw you. After you finish it, he saw you. All you have to do is turn to him. Lord, I know you know. I know you saw me. I messed up. Have mercy. And it is over. And don't ever bring it up to him again. For he said, I am the one that brought out your transgression, and I will not remember your sin no more. When he forgives, he forgets. He placed the delete button. So you yourself, delete it. Don't bring it up. Because when you bring it up, God says, what is he talking about? Jesus, what's he saying? And they check the record, they can't find it. Because the blood don't cover your sin. The blood brought it out. It's like you have a stain. You had too much KFC and something stain on your white shirt. And you use, is it OxyClean they use? And you apply it and the stain is gone. Can you see that stain anymore? But many of us, we still fish it back. And the Lord said, remind me, so we remind me. You see, 2 years ago, God had messed up. And he said, you messed up? What does the record say? The record says the blood. Nobody messes up in the blood. Amen. Many have stopped their prayer. Many have stopped their progress because they don't understand the forgiveness of God. God doesn't cover sin. He blows it out. Amen.
Amen.
Number two thing that will make your prayer effective. You have to pray according to the word of God. You have to pray according to the word of God. You see, when I was growing up, there are some prayers about my parents and the parents around me. It's like incantation. Let me say it in my language. Somebody will help me translate. That if a leaf drop from the tree doesn't get weary. Where is that in the Bible? The road does not close for needle to pass through. All those are the words of the wisdom of men. God is not obligated to answer those prayers. He said, I watch over my words to perform them. Jeremiah 1:12. You have to pray according to the word of God. Psalm 138 and verse 2. Then I will worship, give me the New King James here. Psalm 138 and verse 2. He said, I will worship towards your holy temple and I will what? Praise thy name. Psalm 138 and verse 2. Help me here. For your loving kindness and your tender mercy. For you have what? Magnified your word above all your name. In other words, his word is backed by the glory of his name. God is bound by his word. God is committed to his word. The only thing that God is obligated to put in your life and in my life is what he has promised. If he didn't promise you 12 wives, you can pray and fast. It will never be answered. If it's answered, then the devil is the one that gave you. Amen.
Amen.
As a pastor, I'm praying now. Oh, Lord, help me. I want to divorce my wife and marry the choir leader. But in Jesus' name, it shall be done. He said, I shall decree a thing. It shall be established. That shall never be established.
Yes.
If it happens, it's the devil.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Because he already said, I hate divorce. Most of the choir leader it already belongs to somebody.
Yes.
Amen. You don't use scripture against God. And I see Christians trying to use that. You try to use the word of God against God. Ask for righteousness,
sir. Yes, sir.
Amen.
Amen.
Aha. So let's you have to pray according to the word of God for God to move. You cannot beg God. You cannot fast for 1 year. Make God do what he didn't promise you. He will not move. God will not move outside his word. Amen.
Amen.
Locate scriptures that guarantee answer first before talking to God. First of all, go to the seed bank. This is the situation I'm facing. Lord, give me words like David picked 5 stones. Give me stones that I can hurl at the enemy. You locate them, you prepare your altar, you prepare your heart, then you stand before him and use his word. Lift his up, his word to him, and he will move at his word. Amen.
Amen.
Aha. Proverbs 4:20 said, my son, attend, or in other words, prioritize my word. Give attention. Let your attention be on what I have said. Every situation that happens to us, the first thing we must say is, what has God said about something like this? Amen. It doesn't matter how many people have negative experience. You look for what God has said and stand on it, and you shall have the victory in Jesus' name.
Amen.
The third thing, because of time, is you have to pray for the specifics. And this area, many Christians are challenged there. We think it is sin to ask God for a male child. God, give me child. You know how many sexes of children is available? How many? So if you are saying, okay, God, give me a baby. What do you think God will ask you?
Which one?
God has two types. Which one? Because God doesn't assume. I am talking to you from scripture. Many Christians are missing out on the best of God because they won't tell God what exactly they want. And let's see the story of this man called Bartimaeus. Mark chapter 10. Quickly, let's look at using the New Living Translation, verse 46. It said, then as they reached Jericho, as Jesus and his disciples left out, a large crowd followed them. A blind beggar. See the description, blind beggar, named Bartimaeus, son of Timaeus, was sitting beside the road. What was he doing? Begging. To beg under Jewish custom, you need uniform. You have to be certified. You have to be registered with the city.
Yeah.
So they gave them a vote.
Yeah.
You just can't get out of your house and go in begging. Who? You have to wear beggar's coat. The city must recognize you are a beggar. You must have your own area. That's what that's for you. His own area was beside the highway. Amen. Okay, yeah. He was settled there. Then, next verse. When Bartimaeus heard, because he was blind, but he wasn't deaf. He was hearing commotion. People were going back and forth. The ground was unusual that day. And he began to ask people, now, in where I came from, they have some, they sing, but he didn't sing some. Say, hey, what is happening here? What's going on? Somebody tell me. And somebody said, Jesus of Nazareth was what? Passing by. Who is Jesus? That would have been the next question. So they told him, the one that opened blind eyes, the one that used to raise the dead, the one that fed 5,000, said, hey, today is my day. So he began to do what? Jesus. He wasn't whispering. With the scripture we read, said, they cried to God. He lifted up his voice. Have you ever been in a crowd before? If you are not shouting, nobody can hear you. So this man said, today, this one must not pass me by. He said, Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. He began to shout, next verse, let's see what happened. They told him, be quiet. Don't shut your mouth. Doesn't have time. If that man is too busy for a good blind beggar, doesn't have time for you. They yelled at him. So don't listen to people. If Bartimaeus listened to them, he will have died blind.
Yes.
You come to church where I don't want to disturb your neighbor. Ha! You better let your neighbor be disturbed and go home with your own breakthrough.
Yes, sir.
Amen.
Yes.
Ha! But he only shouted louder, thank God for Bartimaeus. The man said, you don't know, but this shame must not go home with me today. Ha! Son of David, have mercy. And then what happened? When Jesus heard, see, God will always hear a cry for mercy. Every time you cry for mercy, you are appealing to the sonship of Jesus. The anointing over him. In the midst of thousands of people, he had one man crying for mercy and he stopped. He stopped. Because many of you, in fact, somebody is here saying, God is too busy for me. He won't hear me. Who am I? I've messed up a lot. No. He will hear you. God has the unique ability to hear billions of prayers at once and to answer them at once. It's not a man, it's not limited. Amen. Jesus had. So he said to him, tell that there is a blind man. There is somebody blind. Tell him to come. They began to search. They located him. Because he didn't stop, he kept shouting. And he said, yeah, down there, yeah, it's by the river, yeah, that's it. Okay, tell him to come. And they said, cheer up, the same people that told him to shut up. But when they saw that he got the attention of God, they said, cheer up, it's your time, it's really your time. It's calling you, let's see what will happen. See, they are spectators. They are waiting to see what your God will do. And they are going to celebrate with you. But this guy knew that today was his day. He threw off that which associated him with begging. He threw off his certificate of begging. Because without this coat, he can't return to beg. When they said Jesus is calling, he said, kind Father, yeah. Who wants it? Take it. Me, I'm not returning yet. That is why the prayer that brother was leading this morning, until you are restless, until you are tired of where you are, until you are stirred up in your spirit, that I am fed up, I can't stay here anymore. I need to step by that. This guy did not say, he's coming, okay. No, he threw it off. Said, no more begging. He ran to Jesus. Hallelujah. The Bible did not tell us how many times he stumbled before he got to Jesus. But he stumbled, but he didn't stop. He ran to him. But Jesus asked him this curious question. That told us we must be specific. Jesus said, what do you want me to do? Right where you are seated, what do you want God to do for you now? Because I discovered some people don't even know what they want. I want a car. Which kind of car? You know how many makers are there? You want a baby, male or female, anyone. So if he gives you a girl, he says, but I thought you would give me a boy. And you do like Adam and blame God. Some people just pray, I want a baby. So God gave them 4 girls. And then they are blaming God. Why did you only me? I only girl. But did you tell him you want a boy? You didn't. You only pray, Lord, give me a baby. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. These are principles that I have tried in my life. I have put them to use. We set out to have 2 kids, a boy and a girl, and we had them. And before the girl was conceived, I told people, as an assistant pastor, my next baby shall be a girl. Because that's what I want from God. He said, what do you want me to do? What do you want? If he's not committed to giving me what I want, he shouldn't have asked him. And the man said, Lord, I want to see it like everybody. I don't want to depend on people. I don't know what kind of plate they used to serve me. whether they wash it at all. They just give me anything. He said that was good for him. And did Jesus tell him, oh no, you carry for some more time? No, what did he tell him? Go, your confidence in my ability has healed you. If his faith can open his eyes, your faith can deliver your immigration baby. Yeah. Your faith can deliver your baby. Yeah. Your faith can change your finances.
Yeah.
It's the same thing. You have the same faith. We have the same spirit of faith. 1 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 13. Amen.
Amen.
You must be specific. Bartimaeus got what he wanted. Faith must anchor on specifics. Hey, it's 1 o'clock. Stop assuming God knows what you need. These people cried to God in the battle, Lord, give us victory. He fought their battle. Amen.
Amen.
Don't tell God, don't ask God where his place is. His face has not left his head. Many murmur and complain, and they think they pray. But I know the scripture says in John 16 that whatever you ask the Father in my name, he will give it to you. Let me just mention the other two, and then I will explain on them if I have the privilege to talk next week, if not the next time I have the privilege. Number four, I won't explain, I'll just mention them. Pray with desperation. Pray with passion. Pray with earnestness. Some of us, when we pray, my Father, yes. I want to go study how Elijah prayed when he was going to call for the rain. The Bible said he put his hands. That's earnestness. How he was able to do that gymnastic, I don't know. But what does that symbolize? It's not that you two have to go put your head under you will break your back. Don't try that. But if that was put there to signify the earnestness, you can check. Now next week we'll talk about the book of James, chapter 5, verses 16 to 18. You see, heaven is too busy to entertain casual callers. See, some people call my house because I have a TV that will show the number of the person. So when I'm watching TV, I see 800 number. I know it's telemarketers. Shh. That is what heaven does to some other people because they are so casual in their prayer. God doesn't have time to waste for them. And Lord, it is your privilege. Do it. Because God doesn't hear or believe. Number five. We will talk more about this next week. Pray with the name of Jesus. Because I was asking God, how do I explain it? And he showed me a credit card. I know you can all relate to that. I've never seen it until during the night when he showed me. He said, you may get the name on the front right. You may get the credit card number right. But there is a security code at the back. When they ask you, you don't get that right, that credit will not go through. Many prayers, oh, they dress it well. They get the promise, they put it there. But it's the code at the back. It's wrong. They don't pray in Jesus' name, so it doesn't go through. Jesus said, he that told you have not asked anything in my name. He said, from now ask, and you shall receive. Whatever you ask the Father in my name. Whatever you ask the Father in my name. Not in anybody's name. If that prayer is not presented in the name of Jesus, it can never be answered by God. It can never. Amen.
Amen.
Because some of us, we honor our parents more than God. My father, my mother, the God of my mother. Where is that in the Bible? The God of my mother. Who is your mother? It's the name of Jesus that he answers. Amen.
Amen.
Number five, number six, that's the last one. Pray in faith. Not pray in fear, not pray in anxiety. You can undo all your praying if you step into anxiety. These people, the Bible said, they trusted in him. You see, I want you to understand that God is not a drive-through God. When you pray, you may not get response for the next 6 months. But that doesn't mean God will hear you. is busy. It only means he's busy working with the people that must agree. He's working on them day by day. And some human beings will be so stubborn. God wants them to do something, they may drag their feet for 3 months before they do it. But they will do it if you stay in the place there and keep thanking him for it. One of our members just got a breakthrough during last week. And he's talking, he's been telling me about it. I said, okay, so God is good now. He said, yeah, it's good. I said, so that means all the prayers you've been praying for the past 6 or 7 months, they were not wasted. So, Pastor, I know they are not wasted. Amen. God doesn't collect prayer. He doesn't stop prayer. He answers prayer. Daniel prayed, and the Bible said right from the first day, your voice was heard. The answer was sent right from the first day, but there was a delay, not from God's side. Because in the third heavens, in this atmospheric heaven that is above us, that is where the kingdom of Satan is, and that is where the spiritual battle exists. So the angel that was bringing the answer couldn't break through, but your own angel will break through.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
See, grace is the totality of health from above, which will help you to fulfill your destiny. Amen.
Amen.
None of us can go without grace. See, every door, says the Lord, is a possibility which must be taken to God in prayer. Every prophetic release upon you is not going to happen automatically. Without prayer, Paul told Timothy, he said, wage a good warfare with the prophecies that have been released. If you don't wage warfare, they said, I will be rich. I'm going to be rich, you know, I will be rich. Now, my 3 prophets said it. That person may be poorer than the church rats are no more poor. In those days, church rats are poor. Even pay chapel, if there is a rat in this place, it will be so big. Because there's cooking, there's food almost every week, there's bath to drink. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
So what I'm saying is that whatever God has said to you is wrapped in grace. You must wage warfare with it. I've seen many casual Christians, and God said it will be well with me, so it doesn't matter. I don't need, we are under grace, so I don't need to pray. That's why they remain where they are. Because the fulfillment of destiny is for the prayer. Enjoyment of the best of heaven is for the prayer. You must pray earnestly. David said 3 times I pray. You pray in the morning, you pray in the afternoon. Some of us, we only pray about our issue once a week. When we remember? Maybe once a week. Lord, this problem is still there. What is the earnestness here? But you wake up in the morning, Father, specific time. This issue is a shame on your name. It must move. 12 noon, you Father back again. Midnight, you get up again. That is the intensity of prayer that will unlock grace upon your life. We have remained casual too long. It's time to say, I see you walking in the realm of unlimited grace.
Amen.
In the name of Jesus, rise on your feet. Job 22:28 declares, you shall decree a thing, and it shall be established unto you. Therefore, I decree, as a servant of God over this house, that every close destiny, every close future, to open up in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Proverbs 23:18 says, surely there is an end, and your expectation will not be denied. Therefore, as a servant of God, I speak to dreams that have been buried. I speak to desires that have been forgotten, expectations that have been left behind. I command them to be resurrected in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Be resurrected in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Listen, if Lazarus came forth out of the womb, buried, tied down inside the tomb, your dream shall not die.
Amen.
Your expectation will not perish. To be a second class citizen.
Amen.
They may call you illegal today, but you will be a landowner tomorrow.
Amen.
I read that in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Your best days are right in front of you.
Amen.
Receive it in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
From now on, your your prayer altar. You see, a prophet was sent to go and prophesy on the legal altar that they set up. Because the king, God said, this is where you should pray. He said, no, you will do it here. And the prophet came and prophesied on that altar. And the king stretched forth his hand. He said, catch that man. The hand that he put forward, that hand didn't come down. It dried up. See, every demonic altar that is raised against your destiny, today in the name of Jesus, they shall dry up. What about you?